Today, let's think about the graceful little Ionic temple dedicated to the goddess Athena Nike. Nike, the Greek word for victory, up on the Athenian Acropolis built between 427 and 424 BCE. After exploring the temple and its sculpture, we'll then consider the ancient cult of Athena Nike, and then how it ended up inspiring the name of the largest sportswear company in the world. The Temple of Athena Nike was the last temple constructed on the Acropolis in Athens, but a shrine to that goddess had been located in the Acropolis gateway area since 566, over 100 years before the temple's building. A decree in 447 authorized its construction, so we know its planning had stretched over decades. The name of this temple's architect is unknown, but the building fits beautifully into its architectural context. See how its Ionic forms complement the Doric gateway, called the Propylaea, that it adorns. Athena Nike's temple is situated on an elevated bastion overlooking this approach to the Acropolis, the hilltop sacred center of the ancient city-state of Athens. As you can see in this plan, the enclosed inner area that we call a cella is roughly square in shape, and there are four Ionic columns both in the front porch and in the back of the temple. Back when it was built in the 5th century BCE, it was embellished with gleaming metal acroteria and a sculptural frieze with a different theme on each side. For instance, the east side had various scenes, gods hanging out, they're seated, standing, whereas the temple's south frieze was devoted to showing combat between Greeks and Persians, which appears a lot in ancient Athenian art. After the temple was built, which you might remember was in the 420s, a sculptural balustrade was added in about 410, including this relief sculpture of the goddess Nike adjusting her sandal, probably the best known element of the temple. These balustrade reliefs were about a meter high, making a parade of Nike figures, insistently reiterating the theme of victory in combat. This is the best preserved fragment. It's now in the Acropolis Museum. Notice the goddess's precarious posture as she leans in to adjust her sandal. Her clothing is sculpted to articulate, with its clinging folds, the lines of her body from leg through her torso. The sense of movement, of transience, points to the way this sculpture is just on the edge of the transition to the late classical style of Greek sculpture. The ancient travel writer Pausanias also found this sculpture interesting and noted that the Athenians chose to depict their victory figures without wings in hopes that they wouldn't fly away and leave them luckless in battle. When Pausanias wrote that, he was probably thinking about the many images of Nike with wings, such as the Hellenistic sculpture now in the Louvre called Nike of Samothrace, which you've probably seen. Whereas the Temple of Athena Nike, where the goddess of victory combines with the city of Athens, patron goddess Athena, Nike assimilates with other gods in the ancient world, such as Zeus, which crops up at his cult site at Olympia. Likewise, in the 4th century, Alexander the Great issued gold coins such as this one, where his name is paired with the standing figure of Nike on the reverse, showing again Nike's strident connotations in the ancient world with military conquest. Fast forward a few millennia to 1971, and a certain up-and-coming running shoe company based in Oregon chose to take the name of the ancient goddess of victory when it became Nike. Portland State University graphic design student Carolyn Davidson was hired to create a logo for this new company, and invoking the name's ancient associations of victory and swift movement, she developed the Nike swoosh, which in some minor tweaks has remained the hallmark of this company's products. Thus we see how a 5th century BCE temple in ancient Greece played a role in crafting, with a little help from a PSU student, the public identity for Oregon's largest company.